Why are we here? I mean, why did we get all dolled up in our black tie and gowns? Is this just another AIDS benefit awash with red ribbons and good intentions? I mean, what are we doing here at Riverside Church? I mean, it's pretty, but it's a weekday. Well, perhaps it's because we believe that there is strength in numbers. Perhaps it's because we believe that something special is in the air, and we are hoping that whatever it is, it will wash over us. Perhaps it's because we hope to be the part of the healing that will happen here tonight. Perhaps through song and prayer, we can find the strength to come to terms and find the peaceful place that makes it possible to go forward fresh and renewed. So we let go of the glamour of it and go for the glory of it, a shared awakening. Tonight we are fixing to do battle, honey, and we ain't playing. Because this opponent has the ability to turn individuals into statistics. Statistics that say nothing about the 12-year-old girl who has lost both parents to it, or the grieving mother who tells everybody that her son died from kidney failure, or the dying woman who, seeking final solace in the house of her Lord, is forbidden from drinking from the communion cup. This opponent's reach is wide and deep and slashing, and it is ripping us apart physically and spiritually, and it's engulfing our families and our communities. Its name is AIDS. But we can fight it if we are armed with education, advocacy, compassionate caregiving, and prayer. These four things are rooted naturally and traditionally in the church. And that is why we are here tonight. On this occasion, we are here to support the bomb in Gilead as it mobilizes black churches to bring to bear on the AIDS crisis the full force of the African American community and spirituality. On this occasion, we are here to turn the tide. On this occasion, we are here to lift up the bomb in Gilead. Let us revel in the glorious music which springs from our black church. Let us come to a place of peace, to a place of power, and to a place of healing.
Jesus, my all, to heaven is gone. Home.
Said, in this here place, we're flesh. Flesh that weeps, laughs, flesh that dances on bare feet in grass. Love it hard. Yonder they do not love your flesh. They despise it. They don't love your eyes. They just as soon pick them out. No more do they love the skin on your back. Yonder they flay it. And, oh, my people, they do not love your hands. Those they only use, tie, bind, chop off, and leave empty. Love your hands. Love them. Raise them up. Kiss them. Touch others with them. Pat them together, stroke them on your face, because they don't love that either. You got to love it. You. And no, they ain't in love with your mouth. Yonder, out there, they will see it broken and break it again. What you say out of it, they will not heed. What you scream from it, they do not hear. What you put into it to nourish your body, they will snatch away and give you leaving instead. No, they don't love your mouth. You got to love it. This is flesh I'm talking about here. Flesh that needs to be loved. Feet that need to rest and dance. Backs that need support. Shoulders that need arms. Strong arms, I'm telling you. And oh, my people out yonder, hear me. They do not love your neck unnoosed and straight. So love your neck. Put a hand on it. Grace it. Stroke it. And hold it up. And all your inside parts that they just as soon slop for hogs, you got to love them. The dark, dark liver, love it. Love it. And the beat and beating heart, love that too. More than eyes and feet, more than lungs that have yet to draw free air, more than your life-holding womb and your life giving private parts. Hear me now. Love your heart, for that is the prize. Saying no more, she stood up then and danced with her twisted hip the rest of what her heart had to say, while the others opened their mouths and gave her the music. Long notes held until the four-part harmony was perfect enough for their deeply loved flesh.
These words come from interviews conducted by me for this balm in Gilead Everything that you will hear is verbatim as shared by the speaker. Reverend Elijah Weaver, Daniel. The first how Daniel went in the lion's den. They put Daniel in the lion's den. They put him in the lion's den so he could be ate by the lions. And Jesus went in there with him. And when he went in there, he made the lion to lay down and he could be a pillar to Daniel's head. Yeah, that Bible said that he made the lion to lay down so he could be a pillar for Daniel, somewhere to lay his head, and slept with the lion. And they didn't do him no harm, because only Jesus could have done it. Because the lions, when they put the lions in it, and when they put them in the lion den, those lions wasn't tame. See, like you see where that the circus have. See that where most people working with lions in the circus, that they be trained and they be tame. But those was wild lions when they throw Daniel in the lion's den. But see, when God got his hands on you, Mr. Frank Bermejo, regarding Mr. Frank Portolano. They put him on a cot, they put in a cot in the room for me, and I remember climbing into bed with him and telling him that I loved him. And I told him, it's okay, babe, you can go on if you want to. Because I really thought he was, you know, I don't know how much people can hold on for you, but I wanted him to know that as much as I mean, I had been a really big pest, you know, like you can't die, you can't die, you have to hold on. But I just wanted him to know that he could, and it was okay. And I apologized again for being a nag, and he said, you're not a nag. And I told him I was going to miss him a lot. And then he told me, and by this time he looked a little like E.T. because his head was so little coming out of the sheet. And he took, and his hands were underneath the sheet, and he took his hands out of the sheet and he placed them on my shoulder. And he said, you will never be alone. If you feel something, it'll be me. I'll be right here. And he touched me on the shoulder. And that was really wonderful. And he sort of slipped off into sleep. And I just stayed up for the rest of the night in a big chair. I couldn't go to sleep. And by that time, they already started giving him morphine. And my mom was coming down on a bus before the end to see Frank. And her bus was coming into Port Authority at 5:30. So I told Frank, I said, Frank, I'm going to go and pick up Mom, but I'll be right back. And a friend of ours was there too. And he said that Frank followed me out of that room. And that his eyes were completely, he said that man loved you so much that his eyes followed you everywhere in that room. And when you left, his eyes were with you. He followed you right out of that room. And so I said that I was going to come and bring Mom, so she wanted to see him, but that I would be right back. And when I got back at 6 o'clock, he had already fallen into a coma. And so I didn't really speak to him again. But I kept climbing into bed with him and telling him that I loved him in his ear. And there were like no lights in the room. It was almost like a church. And
the nurses were no longer giving medical care anymore. They were trying to comfort him. They would just like put their hand on his head and pat him. And the nurses were so amazing. What dignity. Rita, Janet, Susan, Olivia, that they took this horrible thing and they made it into such a dignified thing. And they treated me with the full respect of a spouse. And so I sat up with my legs propped up on the end of Frank's bed, and I just stared at him. And at about 1 o'clock, I think 1:24, because his breathing had gotten really slow, and it had so many breaks in it that every once in a while, we would think that he had stopped breathing. So at 1:24, I heard and I saw his last breath. And I said, "Shh, listen, he stopped breathing. He's not coming back." And sure enough, and so we gathered around him and we got a little hysterical. And the nurses came in and said that they had to do some things. Could we please go out? But then we could come back in. And when we came back in, when we had been there before, Frank, he looked like an angel sleeping. His hands were crossed and he looked so adorable. But when we came back in, they had laid him flat, and his head had gone back, and his mouth was open, and it was not an appealing sight. And he had some books and a Walkman, and I said, "I don't care about any of this stuff. This cannot be the last thing that I remember." I said, "We have to get out of here," and we left. We just flew out of there. And we took a cab, and we got in a cab, and when we got home, my mother was there. And Frank's sister, my mother, and me, we just all got into me and Frank's bed and went to sleep. Reverend Weaver. Prayer for sickness. Prayer for comfort. In a time of trouble and sickness, you can read Psalm 91, 11th verse. I'm going to find the Psalm 91, 11th verse. "For he shall give his angel charge to keep thee in all thy ways." That's Psalm 91, the 11th verse. "For he shall give his angel to keep thee in all thy ways." Okay, as we live day by day, God gonna let his angel guide us day by day. And see, we can't see the angel. It's like the wind. No man could see the wind. But we can see in what direction the wind is going. So we can't see the angel, but the angel is here. And he will give you willpower if you accept it. Because you have to help yourself before God can step in. Because you see, God can heal you in an instant of a minute. Because we realize that God could heal this land. We realize that God was God all by himself. So you see, now, God can heal you in an instant of a minute. Can I get a witness? Amen. Amen. Because they see now, but if you just, you got to make that first step. Because he said, if you just make that first step, if you just make that first step, I'll make two.
There's a man
death is that man taking names? Oh, death is that man is taking names. He has taken my sister's name, and he's left my heart in pain. There's a man.
Sometimes, for many of us, it's hard to say the name of someone who's died from AIDS. The depth of the loss draws the breath from our bodies. We can't call the name. The memory is painful because memory hurts, and we've trained ourselves not to invite or to invoke pain. But if we can find the way to turn that pain into something greater than our singular sadness, to turn it into a collective understanding that we are not alone, then perhaps memory can become joyous and shared. I think most of you are familiar with the Names Project. The project has created an immense quilt commemorating the lives of people who have died from AIDS. The process of making a panel for the quilt is a healing one. By identifying people who have died, by using needle and thread and emotion to give lasting substance to the work and to the lives of people with AIDS, we find release. We find healing. I want us to use the spirit of the AIDS quilt. Help me tonight. Help me construct a verbal AIDS quilt. Tonight, I want us to take a moment to call out now the names of those we have loved and admired, to proclaim out loud the names of those we have worked with or maybe never even got to know. But somehow they touched us and who are now gone because of AIDS. Please help me. I will begin by naming those I have lost. And then I invite the artists and the choir and you, the congregation, to complete the quilt by joining in. Take as much time as you need. Speak when the spirit moves you. As you call the name or names, whether one or many, stand up. Let us together move from darkness to light tonight. Let us together call out loud the names of those we've lost. Let us bring their spirits into this church tonight to be part of the healing consciousness which we are creating. Ron Holder, Michael Peters, Emil Ardolino, Sammy Thackeray, Brian McCarthy, Casey Smith, Kenny Vetter, Jim Taylor, Ed Mock, Rick Reese, Rob Reese, Rodney Angel Price, Joe Alone, Tracy Rhodes, Arnie Zane, Guilford Blackswan, Bill Castle, Fred Walker, Gary Adams, Stephen Chase, Michael Aprato, Robert Johnson, Ricky Ray, John Miller, John Peterson, Bob Brecht, Bill Hunter, Melissa Martinez, Brad Davis, David Anderson, Liberace, Elizabeth Glasser, Frankie Piazza, Willie Smith, Ryan White, Freddie Mercury, Way Bandy, Robert Reed, Rock Hudson, Rudolf Nureyev, Michael Bennett, Ariel Glasser, Howard Crabtree, Ray Sharkey, Arthur Ashe, Kevin Hall, Dak Rambo, Alvin Ailey.
Thank you.
Effort to move beyond the fear and helplessness of AIDS has drawn to this church tonight a very special person. He is my friends and my friend. A man who's been traveling and singing his message of hope and healing about AIDS for a long time. He's a man who brings his enormous talent and worldwide celebrity to break the silence around AIDS. He established a foundation, the Elton John AIDS Foundation, in 1992. And since that time, the foundation has distributed more than $9 million internationally. Family, brothers and sisters, I am beyond honored that Elton John has come here to share with us this powerful message.
Father, Mother, God, here we are. frail and fragile fathers, moaning and mourning mothers, sad sisters, bereaving brothers, loveless lovers, here we are. We have come in your awesome presence here in the sacred womb of the world from which we have all begun our lives. Here we are. Here tonight we have brought our dreams and our visions. Here tonight we have brought the awards of our achievements, the ashes of our disappointments. Here tonight, Creator, we have clashed our cymbals and struck our drums. We have, in the hope of healing, danced to the glory of God and the resurrection of human beings. Here tonight, our great writers have read and spoken graciously the words of redemption. Our singers have opened their golden throats and sung notes which were created before the first stone looked up at the stars. Here we are, Creator. Here we are in the names of all those precious beloveds who have been consumed by the seemingly insatiable maw of AIDS. Here we are in the names of those besieged now by the greedy monster, AIDS. Here we are. For the children yet to be born, bearing within their own bodies the seeds of their destruction. Here we are tonight, and here we are claiming a healing. We claim an end to the witless murder of our best, of our own, of our fathers and brothers, our mothers, sons and daughters, our beloveds. Here we are claiming healing, for we acknowledge our kinship, our bloodship, our spiritual oneness. Here, we accept that as human family, until we all subdue the ravening beast AIDS, we are all subdued by the ravening beast AIDS. Tonight we say joyously, we do believe there is balm in Gilead. We do believe that we can use the balm to heal our broken bodies, our injured souls, our sad hearts. We do believe there is a balm in Gilead. We do believe. Amen.
Thank you.